Nothing is more irritating than to think you're going to watch a serious film and you end up laughing through most of it. Taps is such a movie. It is somewhat thought-provoking, though. It's about a group of military students who defend their school when they learn it's going to be closed. But overall, it's a ridiculous military escapade that's not the least bit believable. The title of the film is correct. They should play Taps for the movie itself because it does die. The setting is Bunker Hill Military Academy, a military prep school with many years of tradition. The school's superintendent and leader is George C. Scott, portraying General Harlan Baich. You get to know the general quickly, although his appearance is rather brief in the film. You begin to realize he is somewhat of a fanatic. Timothy Hutton plays Brian Moreland, the top senior cadet at the school. A highly disciplined, strong, and sensitive student, he leads his fellow students in the takeover of the school to try and save it. Here we see George C. Scott springing the big announcement at commencement exercises.
I have been informed that Bunker Hill Academy is to be closed. All of its buildings torn down, nothing to be left but memories. It is the decision of the Board of Trustees in all their wisdom that this institution be sold and the land developed for its real estate potential. I am a veteran of many terrible battles. But no battle is more important than this one. And this final battle, I intend to win.
Hutton idolizes Scott and his sense of honor. In the takeover, the students take everything, guns, trucks, they barricade themselves in. One of the student demands is to meet with the board of directors about their decision to sell the school and to build condominiums. And that's one of the film's flaws. We never see a meeting take place. The movie could have been much, much better if a meeting could have happened. In the meantime, all we get is a stalemate. The cadets on the inside, the real military on the outside. You see 11, 12, 13-year-olds ready for battle, as if their puny little rifles are going to stop a tank. George C. Scott's character is the most interesting. His portrayal of General Baich is commendable. The same goes for Hutton. He really tries to give a good performance, even if his character is contradictory in terms of honor and action. Sean Penn is good as Hutton's best friend, and Tom Cruise is splendid as the gung-ho cadet who you learn to hate. Ronnie Cox, as the Army colonel negotiating with Hutton, is quite good. Everyone tries their hardest to make Taps work. There are way too many flaws in the film. And talk about slow pacing.
Sir, how can they do this?
I'm trying to figure that out. The ending, when it finally does come, is depressing. The maker of Taps, they really didn't seem like they knew what they were doing or where they wanted to go in the film. There are so many directions it could have gone, and the end result could have been somewhat of a decent movie. But generally speaking, Taps should retreat and stay behind the lines.
So anybody who isn't 100% sure of what we're doing, take one step forward.
I'm Dino Lally.
You and I have nothing more to talk about.
When you've got a solid cast consisting of John Houseman, Douglas Fairbanks Jr., Melvin Douglas, and Fred Astaire, you would think a movie couldn't go wrong. In Ghost Story, a somewhat disoriented horror film, things go a little haywire. There are two appealing factors in Ghost Story. One is that strong cast. The four veteran film actors add a certain sophistication to the movie. It's a pleasure to watch them on the screen. The chemistry between the four is wonderful. The other appealing factor, being a scary movie, Ghost Story doesn't have a lot of blood and violence. The four men are members of the Chowder Society. They get together and try to scare each other with frightening stories. We sense early on these four men share some deep, dark secret, and whatever it is, it's mad, and it wants revenge. Alice Krieg is the girl in Ghost Story, a rather strange and mysterious woman. She is loved by Craig Wasson. He is in a dual role. He plays Fairbanks' twin sons. One of the sons is sent to his death because of his love for Krieg. When Wasson goes home for the funeral, he meets the other gentleman and begins to piece the mysterious puzzle together. And that puzzle, as it's being put together, holds your attention for a while, but the movie goes back in time to give us background information on how the mystery started. It's here the movie slows down. You can easily lose your orientation of what's really going on. Toward the end, things pick up a little bit. Here in this scene, Astaire, Houseman, and Wasson return to the house where it all started so many years before.
I thought I'd set foot in this house again.
If only we'd been 30 instead of 20.
What fools we
I don't think anybody's here.
She's here. I'm sure of it.
You want to try upstairs?
Nothing will come of this.
You want to stay downstairs, Mr. James?
Not on your life.
It's hard to believe, but all this was so beautiful then. The rooms downstairs and her room up here, just beautiful.
So was Elma's.
All right, that's enough.
We'll all go. Can't be moved. Please, Sears, we stay together.
Ricky, don't argue with me. I'm too old, too tired, and too frightened.
The movie's final scene is the best one, but overall, because the film flip-flops back and forth in time, the pacing is disrupted, and there are just too many unanswered questions at the end of the movie. Why did the ghost wait so long to come back and haunt everybody? The one Chowder Society member who survives, why is he the one who gets off the hook? Who knows? Ghost Story is simply not that scary. I'm Dean O'Lally. Pennies from Heaven deserves a lot of credit in that it tries to be different, original, and the film draws a contrast between the popular 1930s songs, which were in a way escapist entertainment, and the dark reality of that period of time. On the outside, Pennies from Heaven is a daring, innovative musical with great set designs, production, wonderful choreography, decent performances from Bernadette Peters, Jessica Harper, and Christopher Walken. And Steve Martin does a remarkably good job, not only in his acting performance, but in his song and dance numbers. At closer examination, the film has its problems with scripting and character development. I think the key to this movie is to see it in the right frame of mind. Be open to it and its uniqueness. Take it for what it's worth. The plot goes something like this. Steve Martin is Arthur, a Chicago sheet music salesman in the 1930s. He's married to Jessica Harper, a somewhat repressed girl. Martin sees Bernadette Peters, falls in love with her, seduces her, and from there, both of their lives go downhill. Martin is convincing as a dreamer of sorts, and Bernadette Peters as a schoolteacher reminds me of Betty Boop. Here we see Martin show up one night at Peters' house to talk with her.
You've been in my head, Eileen, and in my heart, in my soul. I want to talk to you. Please, let me talk with you.
Eileen?
Who's that?
My brother.
I gotta talk to you.
Eileen, come here.
I don't even know who you are.
Arthur. I'm Arthur. And I love you.
Scattered throughout the movie are original recordings, songs of the 1930s. The actor just mouthed the words. Some of the numbers just spring out of nowhere when you least expect it, like this.
Quiet.
Love is good for anything that ails you. Baby, there is nothing love can do. Love is good for anything that ails you. How's about a sweet romance or two? A kiss will pep you up.
Given the set designs, the choreography, the acting, and especially the courage to do something different, Pennies from Heaven is entertaining. And for you hardcore Steve Martin fans, don't go expecting to see typical Steve Martin stunts, because you won't see any. As I said earlier, Pennies from Heaven does have its flaws, but I don't think they're big enough to take away from the overall effect of the film. I'm Dean O'Lally. Beautifully made, brilliantly acted, On Golden Pond is without a doubt one of the best motion pictures to come out in the last couple of years. The movie had some pre-release publicity which couldn't be helped, such as Henry Fonda's recent illness. And for those of you who didn't hear, Henry Fonda and Katharine Hepburn had never met, let alone worked together, before this film was made. But after you see them together, you will wonder why they waited so long to join their tremendous talents. On Golden Pond is the kind of movie which will make you laugh and cry. There are moments you will do both at the same time. It is a true pleasure to watch these two actors on the screen. Henry Fonda plays a retired professor, Norman Thayer Jr. His wife, Ethel, is portrayed by Katharine Hepburn. The movie opens up with them arriving at their New England house, a cottage they have spent 48 summers on together. Fonda is a snappish, irritable, but humorously lovable man approaching his 80th birthday. You can tell Hepburn is used to his grouchy old ways, but she just rolls with the punches, and she can throw some pretty good punches of her own. One thing is quite clear, these two engaging and adorable people, after a long life together, are still madly in love. Fonda is afraid of old age. He's frightened and preoccupied with the idea of dying. At one point, Hepburn asks him, "Don't you have anything else to think about?" Fonda's answer, "Nothing quite as interesting." Here's one of the most touching scenes in the film. Fonda goes out in the woods to pick strawberries, the woods in which he has spent so much time in the past, but he gets lost and comes running back to the house, extremely frightened.
You want to know why I came back so fast? I got the end of our lane. I couldn't remember where the old town road was. One little way in the woods, there was nothing familiar, not one damn tree. It scared me half to death. That's why I came running back here to you. See your pretty face. I could feel safe. I was still me.
Safe, you old poop. And you're definitely still you. Thinking on poor old Charlie. After lunch, after we've gobbled up all those silly strawberries, we'll take ourselves to the old town road. We've been there a thousand times, darling. Thousand, and you'll remember it all. Listen to me, mister. You're my knight in shining armor. Don't you forget it.
That is quite a scene. Later in the movie, their daughter, played by Jane Fonda, her boyfriend, played by Dabney Coleman, and his son, portrayed by Doug McKeon, come for a visit. We see that Jane is still scared of her father. As she says, she's still answering to him. She feels neglect from her dad. When Jane and Dabney Coleman leave for Europe, they leave Coleman's 13-year-old with the elderly couple. The bulk of the movie is the growing relationship between Fonda and the boy. After a rough start, they become close friends, a relationship that Jane becomes jealous of on her return from Europe. Coleman and McKeon are excellent in their roles. Jane provides an interesting and deep-rooted portrayal of a daughter wanting to resolve a feuding relationship with her father. Mark Rydell's direction is fantastic. He captures the true beauty of the setting and the people. And as for Hank and Katie and the movie itself, classy people with classic acting in a superb motion picture. A film about old age, dying, love and relationships. A fabulous and spectacular movie that everyone should see. And if you don't, you're missing something very, very special. I'm Dean O'Lawley. Through the years, there have been numerous movies dealing with the creatures of nature. You had King Kong, Ben, The Swarm dealing with killer bees, Wolfen, and of course, we all remember the film which by its title sounded like the life story of Howard Cosell, the movie about a killer shark. Get out of my face, your history. A new movie which is slithering into local theaters now is Venom. Now, if you don't like snakes and are easily frightened by them, you probably won't like Venom. If you do like snakes and they don't bother you at all, you still won't like Venom. The movie takes a weak attempt at being a suspense thriller. Here's the star of the show. That's him, or her. I guess it doesn't matter. The main action of the film stems from an aborted kidnapping attempt. A snake is loose in the house where the kidnappers are held up, but not just any old snake, the deadly poisonous mamba snake. An interesting premise. Too bad the makers of the movie didn't do anything with it. It is interesting, though, because the snake endangers not only the bad guys, but the good guys as well. The brains behind the kidnapping is Klaus Kinski. He is aided by Oliver Reed and Susan George. Their target is a young boy, Lance Holcomb, who lives in London. And Reed and George are the boy's servants, and Sterling Hayden plays the rich boy's grandfather. After the kidnapping attempt fails, they lock themselves in the house. Reed goes nuts and shoots a policeman. Needless to say, a confrontation ensues between the kidnappers and the London police. They are led by Nicole Williamson. Before all of this happens, though, the boy, who by the way suffers from asthma, accidentally picks up the wrong snake at a pet shop. It gets loose in the house and, of course, is a threat to everyone. The film's pacing is slow with periodic spurts of surprise. In this scene, Sterling Hayden talks Kinski into letting him get the boy's medication after he suffers an asthma attack. And then, guess what?
Look, just let me go upstairs and get the boy's medicine.
Let's go.
I'm thirsty. I fancy a drink. How about you?
Why not?
Yeah. Yes, it'll help us relax, won't it?
What would you like? We've got
whiskey, brandy, gin. I think we've got most things.
I think I'll have a whiskey.
Coming up.
What is it?
Some of the interesting aspects of the film are the wide-angle shots from the subjective viewpoint, the snakes. I found them to be boring and predictable, with the performances being above average. And I hate to admit, some of the death scenes are, let's say, spectacular. But overall, it was as if the script was written concentrating on the kidnapping, and then at the last second, the snake was thrown in for effect. It just doesn't work. Venom slowly sizzles and has no bite whatsoever. I could be wrong, you know. Obviously aimed at the teenage market, Private Lessons tries but fails in its attempt at presenting a humorous picture of a young boy's introduction to sex. How is he introduced? Well, his mate is the teacher. The very rich 15-year-old boy is portrayed by Eric Brown. His father, Ron Foster, while playing around on a business trip, is not the only one playing around. His son is being taught about the facts of life by his maid, portrayed by Sylvia Crystal. She apparently has orders to do this by the time the father returns from his business trip. The script is generally weak, but is a little better where it presents an innocent boy put in a potentially sexual situation. Eric Brown's character is not stuck up, and he basically puts in a good performance. The same goes for Sylvia Crystal. There's another plot headed by the chauffeur, played by Howard Hessman. His dry character provides some laughs, but not many. Eric's best friend, Patrick Piccaninny, really gets most of the laughs as he coaches the young adolescent through this situation. The movie's direction, though, is terrible. It has some real problems. The musical score for Private Lessons is made up of current rock artists such as Rod Stewart and Eric Clapton. The bedroom scenes between the boy and the maid are somewhat awkward, but they're not as bad or tasteless as you might think. Some scenes, though, are completely worthless. I can't recommend Private Lessons because of the numerous flaws, mainly the script. It's not funny. And the direction. The acting is not great, but it's not terrible either.
Are you ready for your private lesson today?
I sure am. Let's go. She's giving me lessons on how to play the French horn. If you're looking for a movie where you can sit back, relax, laugh, and have a good time, then Soggy Bottom USA should fit the bill. Most of the humor is cornball. It's a little silly at times, but still fun. The movie's set in Louisiana around 1931, and Soggy Bottom has an impressive cast, who, when the script begins to slow down, can take out the slack and keep things going. Veteran film actor Ben Johnson stars as Soggy Bottom's sheriff. I love his name, Isom Gorch. How's that? A good man, stern, likable, and fair. His cousin is played by a wonderful character actor, Dove Taylor. He runs the local watering hole, and of course, he takes pride in his homemade moonshine whiskey. He keeps busy keeping the liquor from the revenuers, headed by and very well portrayed by Anthony Zerbe. He's on the left. The town is gearing up for its annual coon dog race. The favorite is Sissy, owned by Ben Johnson. But it appears Sissy is going to get some stiff competition this time around. A prize-winning coon dog owned by an ostentatious country and western singer, Ann Wedgeworth, enters the race. She causes some minor problems when she tries to take Ben Johnson away from his girlfriend, portrayed by Lewis Nettleton. Here's a quick look at some of the goings-on in Soggy Bottom, USA.
It's being manufactured here illegally.
Most likely.
Paul, listen, the revenues are coming.
Revenues.
You want me back here to warm up your bed again?
I sure do, honey.
Then get yourself a ring and a preacher.
You're all under arrest for public drunkenness. Now you can all go on with your festivities.
When Orville and Wilbur were ready, they didn't wait for nothing. They just took off.
And some people do take off, literally, in the film. Jack Elam provides some shotgun action in his typical villainous role. You've got chases of automobiles and motorcycles. The stunts and chases are great in the movie, very impressive. They're as good, if not better, than a lot of the stunts and chases in other films. And the action is not confined to the ground. There are some dangerous boat stunts that are pulled off superbly. It's the only way to fly. The performances are very good. Ted Flicker's direction keeps the picture moving. It's beautifully photographed. The humor is countrified. And there's a running gag about a dog who, well, let's say he doesn't know how to spell relief. So if you're a good old boy, and even if you're not, you'll enjoy Soggy Bottom, USA. Las Vegas, Nevada, entertainment capital of the world. Here, everything is done in a big way. Big acts, lots of lights, and even big movies. Very big movies. Housed in this Genesic Dome is one of the 9 largest movie screens in the world. Inside, the present meets the future. It is called Omnimax. Richard Haynes has worked for 7 years in developing the Omnimax system and explains its operation.
The Omnimax film, like I said, is 10 times the size of a 35-millimeter frame. The soundtrack is separate from the standard 35. It's projected onto the screen with a fisheye lens, rather than your standard, and it's projected with a 12,000-watt water-cooled lamp. The projector is 18 feet up off the ground, for one thing.
The key to this unique system is the rolling loop. In normal projectors, the film is pulled through the projector from top to bottom. In Omnimax, the film goes through sideways at a speed of 366 feet per minute. The sound is also very unique. Within the theater, there are 89 separate speakers feeding 9 channels of sound. Over 400 people are seated for each performance. Omnimax truly offers a variety of visual experiences. Currently playing is a film called Our Living Planet. Wonderful panorama views of waterfalls, tropical rainforest, and wild herds of antelopes surround the viewer. Whether this Omnimax process will ever replace the standard 35-millimeter movies that we normally see is certainly doubtful. However, its future is considered secure. I'm Dean O'Lally. Add the following ingredients. Good actors, a true story about two families who make a courageous and daring escape to West Germany from East Germany, and what do you get? Well, unfortunately, you get a movie that doesn't completely work. The potential is there, but the makers of Night Crossing, Walt Disney, just did not develop it. The storyline, as I said, is based on a true story. In 1978 and 79, two families escaped from East to West Germany in a hot air balloon they built themselves. John Hurt, Jane Alexander, Doug, and Keith McKeon play one family. Bo Bridges, Glennis O'Connor, Jeffrey and Michael Lysak portray the other. Hurt and Bridges are construction workers. They're tired of life in East Germany, so together they come up with a plan to escape. Make your own hot air balloon. But what if you don't know anything about it?
We can learn. I mean, compared with building an airplane or a helicopter, it's simple.
How much do you need?
1,250 square yards.
Gentlemen, if this is your idea of a joke...
The SSD is looking for us. You know they are.
Here's a trailer. Always coming and going at night.
I want special emergency precautions taken at every border station.
We're not testing it first?
No, we don't have the time. If the weather's good and the wind's right, then we go.
Emergency alert.
The first escape attempt fails, just like the first hour of the film. The second attempt is successful, like the second hour of the movie. Night Crossing's first 60 minutes moves rather slowly, setting everything up for us. The second half, the action picks up with the ending being exciting, beautiful, and triumphant. And although our two families are saved, the movie is not. We're glad for the people, and we feel for them, and we like them. And it's difficult not to get caught up in their adventure. If only the makers of Night Crossing had developed the script and overall events a little better. Miscasting is also evident in the film. Set in East Germany, British actor John Hurt heads one family, while Americans Beau Bridges and Glennis O'Connor remind me of a California couple. Too bad. So it's sad to say, Night Crossing gets its own wires crossed and never really gets off the ground. I'm Dean O'Lally. Every so often, a film comes along that stays with you long after you leave the theater. The film in this case is called Chariots of Fire. It has a certain magical and special quality. The story is about courage, competition, struggling, and individual principle. Chariots of Fire is based on two athletes working to compete in the 1924 Olympics, Eric Little of Scotland and Harold Abrahams of England. These two characters are very well played by Ian Charlson and Ben Cross. By the way, both are making their film debut, as is the director, Hugh Hudson. He does a superb job. Little and Abrahams run for different reasons. Little, a missionary, believes his athletic ability is a gift from God, and he says he runs to honor God's name. Abrahams is Jewish, a law student at Cambridge University. He runs merely to win and to triumph over the anti-Semitism in the world. With that bit of information, here's a beautiful montage of scenes set to the film's title song. Absolutely beautiful. Chariots of Fire shows these two men, the way they train, their personal relationships, all of which lead up to the 1924 Olympics. The movie also has an impressive cast of veteran actors, Sir John Gielgud, Ian Holm, Brad Davis, and Lindsay Anderson. A film about striving for excellence. It will make you feel good. Chariots of Fire should be seen by all. I'm Dean O'Lally. Never in my life have I seen such a disgusting excuse for a movie. Caligula, in essence, is a $17 million semi-pornographic excuse for Penthouse to try and make films. Oh, there are some big names in it, such as John Gielgud, Malcolm McDowell, and Peter O'Toole, but there is no way they can pull this low-life celluloid out of the dirt. What is Caligula about? Well, this is what they say. It's about, quote, the short but memorable reign of the infamous Roman Caesar, unquote. It tries to show us what life was really like in pagan Rome. Now, I've studied history, and I know that life was as it's shown in the film. It's no bed of roses. But it's the way they presented it. We see orgies, decapitations, castrations, and extremely bad acting. Caligula looked as if it was filmed through a jar of wax. It's 2.5 hours of garbage as we follow Caligula, played by Malcolm McDowell, from youth to self-proclaimed God. It shows not only the sex and perversions, but the politics of the day.
Don't let me die.
Dying is too good for this movie. That's all I'm going to say, except for the fact that it's disgusting, repulsive, and offensive. Oh yes, the film Caligula is also a piece of trash. I'm Dino Lally.